I've been watching a lot of news about the coverage of this, and it's, you know, Muslims versus Republicans and this and that. But all the commentators, both on the left and the right, are ignoring the fact completely that this is all about property rights. That if you respect property rights, you know, this is a non-issue. Other than the fact that you may disagree what they want to do with their land, okay, maybe, you know, and that's your right to disagree. You can protest and this and that. But ultimately, the individual, and I forget his name, purchased the land. I think he bought it for something like $4.5 million. Apparently, no one ever asked him what he wanted to do with it, or it wasn't such a big issue when they sold it to him. But he decided to build a mosque, which I'm pretty sure you still have the right to practice your religion and do and to develop your land as you see fit. So one solution that I was talking with a friend, Eric Andreessen, who has actually been on the show as well. He wrote an article recently that said, well, here's a solution for all those people who are really upset. Why don't you get the 70 some odd percent of New Yorkers, or even people from around the world? I think the national poll is somewhere between 60 and 70% of people don't approve of the building, or don't. I think property should be sacred in this, and not just you know, the outrage that so many people are expressing.
Spoken like a true property rights advocate. Welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. I'm Richard Fields. On the program this evening, we have Mike Sertic, who is on the executive board for Students for Liberty. Welcome to the show. We have Devon Minnema and Natalie Cuzmenco, who are both with Young Americans for Liberty. And you're the Natalie, you're the president of the Young Americans for Liberty. Students for Liberty. I'm sorry, Students for no Young Americans for Liberty. I gotta keep all this straight. At Elon University.
Chapter at Elon University.
And that's in North Carolina.
Yes.
Okay. What are you doing in California?
I'm here volunteering with Gary Clough's campaign with Devin.
Oh, okay. So you're both getting your feet wet with active campaigning here at the grassroots level.
Yes.
Having fun yet?
Yeah.
Good. Good. What are the big issues in the Gary Clough campaign? What's happening on the ground?
Well, I think right now what we're trying to push is that you know, there needs to be more common sense in our fiscal policy, and I think right now the main issue that we're pushing is the national debt, since, you know, our opponent is for more of a spend ideology.
Your opponent is?
Yeah. So
who is your opponent?
John Garamendi, okay, of the 10th Congressional District, right, which includes Dixon, California, and then Fairfield, Walnut Creek, and I think just a little tiny piece of Sacramento.
Rural Sacramento County, mm-hmm. I think, yeah.
Yeah.
Now, you're from Dixon, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
How did you get involved in politics? You're in Dixon High School, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
Is that correct? What year?
I'm a sophomore this year.
Okay.
And I started the chapter last year over at Dixon High School. But, you know, the way that I got involved in politics was kind of a progressive thing. My mom was a journalist and my father was a talk radio addict. so between
so
the
you,
two.
You grew up listening to Rush and Sean? And that,
yeah,
kind of thing?
Yeah,
okay.
My dad says that I was a Rush baby,
uh-huh,
not a Gerber baby.
Okay.
So, you know, it was just kind of a setup. And then my brother ran for public office here in Sacramento for the American River Flood Control District, and he was a libertarian, so I asked him about Ron Paul.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, YouTube took me the rest of the way.
YouTube, okay. So what have you done on YouTube? I've seen a little bit that you've done on YouTube. You're on, your Fox clip was on YouTube. I heard you speak at a Tea Party rally on YouTube. What else have you done?
Well, I mean, I've organized several Tea Parties now. I did one on campus, and then there were two off campus. The first one that really started me off was when it was just me on the corner of Highway 113 and A Street, our main intersection. So after that, I kind of vowed to myself, you know, I will have more people there. You know,
what are the principles? What are the Tea Party platform or principles that you're espousing?
Well, I believe that the Tea Party has libertarian roots. Actually, one of the people who first hosted a Tea Party was Trevor Leach. And he is a member of Young Americans for Liberty. He's a libertarian, and there are many basic principles that I think the Tea Party can espouse that are libertarian. And I think as it gets bigger, it's you know, it's harder to keep the farther out, you know, from being just within that core of libertarianism. But, you know, that's our job. If we keep working on it, then we can, you know, get more people to enter the movement.
Now, how did you get involved at Elon University? How did you get involved in the organization?
Well, I'm going to be an incoming freshman there.
Okay.
And while I was in school, I was taking a lot of...
Now, you're talking in high school, you mean?
Yeah, in high school. I took a lot of classes, just, you know, like government and economics and stuff. And then I met Jared Fuller, and he introduced me to all these, you know, crazy new concepts and Ron Paul and... you know, I just started doing my research and really looking into it.
Jerry Fuller. Who's Jerry Fuller?
Jared Fuller. He is he's one of the founders of Young Americans for Liberty,
okay,
I think.
Gotcha.
He's like second.
Mm-hmm. He's, I think his official title is the Southeast Regional Director.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So, yeah.
He's a very intelligent person, and he's very well respected over in our region over there because he does a lot
mm-hmm.
in politics. But, mm-hmm. I mean, I started talking to him, and he showed me a lot of different things. And, you know, I started really liking it and realizing, like, you know, this makes sense. This is common sense, you know, transparent, and I like this.
Now, Mike, you've been on the show before, but tell us again how you got involved with, keep them straight here, Students for Liberty.
I would say I also was very heavily influenced by Ron Paul's campaign, actually,
mm-hmm.
although it wasn't until after the campaign was over, and I had... you know, started to see what was going on with the newly elected president, and I didn't like what I was seeing. So I started looking back over the last several months during the campaign and recognized that Ron Paul was one of the few individuals that was actually campaigning who had a very different message. So I started taking a closer look. I got his book, Revolution, A Manifesto, started reading his suggested readings, and from there just... went on an educational journey into the libertarian principles and ideas, and I was amazed by what I was reading because I had never learned any of these things in my classes that I was taking, certainly not at Sac State.
Well, I can imagine that. And but were you learning these things in high school in North Carolina?
I mean, not in class per se, but
okay.
You know, on my own, I
yeah.
was doing my own
yeah.
research
yeah.
during class.
No, are you a rabbi too, or?
No, my parents are. You know, my parents are very religious, conservative people, but.
Okay.
They were always kind of like independently doing their own thing when it
mm-hmm.
came to politics.
Mm-hmm.
Just like looking into it, like watching the news, forming their own opinions, and
mm-hmm.
you know, like they didn't really let like talk show hosts and people like Sean Hannity influence what they think.
So you're all independent thinkers here.
Yeah.
Which is what leads everybody to be libertarian eventually, right? Okay. Devon, I'm fascinated by the fact that the signature page on your email says presidential candidate for 2044.
That's right.
Is that when you turn 35 or something?
No, actually, I'll be 49 in 2044. So,
oh, well, why wait until you're 49?
Well, you know, I figure I don't want to make myself vulnerable to being criticized for being young, so I might as well get a little bit of gray hairs on my side, you know.
I see. Okay, well, you thought it all through then, haven't you?
I'd like to think.
Okay. What kind of a political trajectory gets you to running for president in 2044? You got it all planned out?
Well, I wouldn't say that I have it all perfectly planned out, but I know that there are a couple of stops along the way that need to happen. And, you know, I know that I want to work in the private sector before I go into politics. My father owns a farm, and I'll probably one day own that farm, so I want to make sure that I have a full understanding of agricultural policy and, you know, how the entire thing works and runs. And, you know, I do like working with my hands. So,
what kind of farm?
It's a tomato farm.
Oh, okay.
Well, we do other crops. We have some fresh market corn and cucumbers, cantaloupe, watermelon, that kind of stuff. But mostly tomatoes and lima beans.
Tomatoes for processing into
mm-hmm.
Into ketchup and so forth?
Yeah. Correct.
Okay. Okay, and what do you have your political career planned out as well, Natalie?
Well, right now I'm pre-law at Elon, so I intend
okay.
to do that. You know, hopefully go into the law field and work my way into politics from there.
Okay. on taxes, that's, you know, you're talking about reducing the federal deficit, balanced budget and all that sort of thing. In order to do that, you have to do one of two things. You have to, or one of three things. You have to either increase taxes, lower spending, or a combination of both, by most, you know, analysis of the situation. Where do you stand on balancing the budget? Would you increase taxes? Would you reduce, would you change the method of taxation? Would you reduce spending? How do you stand?
Well, I'd definitely like to see a change in the way that we do taxing, but as for the national deficit, I think that we need to make sure that we stop spending immediately. And that's the primary thing that we need to be working on.
Okay, that's easy to say. Where do you stop spending?
I think from a farming perspective, I'd like to see a change in our agricultural policies. One of the big targets that I have would be agricultural subsidies, you know, because as a we're still considered a smaller farm. Mm-hmm. And because we're a smaller farm, we don't qualify for most of the subsidies that we would get. Now, the subsidies that are laid out for agricultural producers are primarily for farmers who are over 250 employees, over 150 employees. And, you know, the higher you go, the more subsidies you get instead of the other way around.
I thought farm subsidies were primarily based on feed grains and corn and wheat and that sort of thing.
Yes,
Midwest style crops.
Yeah.
Didn't have too much to do with too much to do at all with the number of employees. Does it?
Well, it is primarily based on the crop, but it's also based on how much of the crop that you're creating. So if you're producing a extremely large amount of grain, well, then you'd be raking in the dough as it's graded. So the higher up you go, the more you get. Which is backwards from what you'd think.
The more you produce, the more subsidies.
Exactly.
I understand that. But, I mean, it's not that labor intensive to produce, for instance, corn.
No, it isn't, which is the surprising thing. However, the farmers, especially here in California, mostly don't produce solely corn or solely, solely wheat, like the Midwest.
Yeah.
Like here what they do is that you'll have one farm where it's wheat as a crop rotation or as another thing where you can bring in some money part of the time and then still manage to produce tomatoes, and if there's a horrific crop failure, you'll have the wheat to back you up because of the subsidies.
I see. Okay. Well, you're obviously talking about cutting federal spending in an area that would hurt your industry, which is admirable. Most people want to cut somebody else's industry. What other industries, what other parts of federal spending do you think should be targeted? And I'm referring specifically to the so-called untouchable Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, those kinds of automatic spending programs. Would you touch them?
Well, I think we have to, definitely, and I think that there's no way to necessarily cut, but I would like to see a phase out of Social Security and Medicare. Obviously, the people who have paid into it, you can't cut off everything that they've paid into it and just say, okay, the program's over. I mean, you'd have to do a progressive thing saying, like, if you paid in for 7 years, you'll get, X amount of services, and we'll phase it out from there. So that eventually by, hopefully 25 years down the line or 50 years down the line, we'll have the program completely phased out. So that's what I'd like to see. And that would also get rid of a large, the little scoop fund that all these different politicians have in Congress, where they can constantly dip into it and, spend it all when it's supposed to be held aside privately.
Mike, where do you see the biggest potential for spending cuts at the federal level?
At the federal level, well, obviously, I mean, you are going to have to start talking about things like Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security. That is where I think we have simply taken on far too many liabilities that really, at this point, are impossible to pay back. So that's not a bad idea, what Devon's talking about. And, I would take it a step further. Even ultimately, we have to go and, I would argue, repeal the 16th Amendment. And income taxes entirely. But once again, you're talking long-term, not short-term, because that's just not feasible.
Natalie, do you have anything to add as far as specific spending programs that should be cut?
I mean, I agree with both of you. I think that phasing it out would make it fair for the people that have paid into it, and it's something that needs to be done.
What about foreign policy?
Well,
are we spending too much money on defense?
Yes.
I'd argue definitely that we are spending way too much money on defense. And
but isn't that what keeps us safe?
Well, that's arguable, to say the least.
Give me your vision of a safe country, a country that's safe from foreign incursions, that spends a whole lot less on the military.
A country that keeps its nose clean and doesn't get into other people's business. If we don't get into other people's business, they don't have a reason to be mad at us. So I think...
So the Costa Rican foreign policy, where there is no military and nobody bothers them?
No, well, I don't know if I take it that far. I think that we do need a modern military of some type. But at the same time, I don't think it needs to be as burdensome as it is right now. You know, I know that it's, for politicians, it's the sacred cow that you can't cut spending in the military, cut spending on troops. But at one point, it is going to become unfeasible. And I think right now, it is very, very close to becoming completely unfeasible.
Now, I'm assuming you guys are not in favor of an entirely watchdog state where there are no taxes at all. If there are going to be federal taxes, what form should they take?
Well, I would say you probably shouldn't make assumptions because
music to my ear.
I probably am a little bit more extreme in that respect. But I mean, as far as what is a legitimate tax, I don't know. We were talking about this a little bit before the show: flat tax versus fair tax.
Okay, flat taxes versus fair tax.
I would say that I actually tend to come out more in favor of a sales tax, because that is a tax on consumption. You know, that is a voluntary tax that people are going to make. They're going to decide what they want to consume. Aside from a consumption tax, there really isn't such a thing as a voluntary tax. Now, you could even make the argument that, okay, so you have to consume, so therefore it's not truly voluntary. But you still get to decide what you're going to consume, and so and you can decide whether or not you want to consume luxury goods that are obviously going to have a much higher tax.
Mm-hmm.
And then I guess the other question is, what do you spend? What is a legitimate expense for government to spend that revenue on? And that's another question entirely. But
I'm assuming though that you would not want a fair tax or a sales tax before the income tax was entirely done away with. Otherwise, you'd end up with two taxes.
Right, yeah, and you couldn't. And that's what you're seeing right now with the whole lobbying for the VAT tax. And, you know, and you would see, you know, people would take the ideas of the fair tax and just implement more taxes on the American people, which is not what we need right now.
Which is, I mean, you know, talking about installing a VAT or a fair tax or whatever you want to call it, a sales tax, mm-hmm. on top of the income tax, I think would be counterproductive and very, very dangerous.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. Is it politically feasible to get rid of, to do both a repeal of the 16th Amendment, which is what you'd have to do to kill the income tax, and install a fair or VAT tax?
Certainly not at this time, but who knows what could happen. The political climate could change down the road.
The federal government's involvement in the economy, of course, has gone from essentially nothing in the Revolutionary War era and shortly after most of the 19th century to a point now where a government at federal, state, and local levels controls 50% plus of the economy. What percentage of the economy should government be involved in? What do you think, Natalie?
Well, that's a question that is debatable for me because my parents are very conservative, not like a traditional conservative, more like a neoconservative. So I was kind of raised with, you know, the idea that the government should have some kind of role. But personally, I think that they should play an extremely limited role. This is just something, I mean, if a role at all, you know, it's just something that economy is not something that really needs to be tied into, you know, government and state affairs. It's kind of something that needs to be left alone. Leave it for entrepreneurs, consumers, let it be up to them to decide for everything.
Is there a role for government regulation in, say, the environmental area?
I mean, if personally, I think that if, you know, if the federal government wants to preserve an area, you know, a specific area, you know, that's up to them. But I don't think that we should be pouring our money that they're stealing from us into that. And I mean, they really shouldn't.
The federal government has no money that doesn't come from us.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, it shouldn't really be.
I'm thinking more in terms of regulation, regulating the amount of pollution, that sort of thing.
Well, I mean, honestly, that's something that I think should be left up to the initiative of American citizens, really, like if it's seriously becoming a problem. And that's something that can become more debatable as we go on down the road. But honestly, I think that it should be up to each individual person.
Mike, what do you think should be the proper role of the regulatory state, if any?
I would say, you know, I understand Natalie's point about, you know, the initiatives, but I think that you're treading into dangerous territory when you leave these sorts of things up to the American people, because how quickly, how fickle are we when we see something like an inconvenient truth pop up or scare tactics by, you know, environmental fundamentalists when, you know, the sky is falling, you know, the climate is changing, you know, so to leave that to an initiative process, I would argue. I would advocate against that.
You're talking about a voter initiative, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
As far as, you know, what is a legitimate regulatory purpose for an environment or such as cap and trade? Mm-hmm. I mean, cap and trade is a terrible idea.
Cap and trade. You know, if you think about cap and trade, I think is kind of misunderstood. The fundamental idea of cap and trade actually came out of Reason Foundation at one point. And the way cap and trade is supposed to work is you would say, okay, we as a country are going to say we'll allow X amount of air pollution, no more. And if you want to have the right to pollute the air, you're going to have to pay for it. You're going to have to pay, in most formulations, pay the government for the right to pollute. Mm-hmm. And then that right to pollute becomes tradable. So mm-hmm. if you figure out a way to run your industry a lot cleaner, you can sell that right to somebody else that has a less efficient process. That way you have a cap on the amount of pollution that's created, and you have a market system for allocating who actually gets to pollute and who doesn't.
Right. The problem.
What is the problem?
I mean, the problem is, first of all, it's difficult to determine what the right amount of pollution is. Secondly, you're creating an artificial market that would not have existed under a free market system.
Right.
So you do have to find a way to deal with the negative externalities of pollution. It is a serious economic problem that, you know, it seems like the only solution is to mandate government regulation to step in either through a tax or some sort of artificial
system. Well, there are only two ways that I'm aware of. One would be a cap and cap and trade system. Mm-hmm. The other would be just arbitrary regulations, X number of pollutants per, you know.
Well, and taxes that mitigate.
Smokes, well, yeah.
Yeah. So.
Which is better, an arbitrary regulation, excuse me, on how much pollution you can put out, or a cap and trade system that lets the market determine how much, who's going to do the polluting and who's not?
I'm not really satisfied with either one of those solutions.
How about you, Devon? Have you thought about that?
Well, I'd have to agree with Mike. I'm not exactly satisfied with either one of those. And especially as coming from an agricultural background, I'd say that cap and trade, although it is a reasonable idea, I think that the main problem is that a lot of the people that are included under the cap and trade system are people who just can't, I mean, from a small farm, the pieces of equipment that we'll have to junk would be, I mean, just completely not feasible for our company. We only have. Like,
are you talking about the CARB regulations?
Yeah. 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 And so, I mean,
that's not really cap and trade. That's the regulatory.
Right, right.
You will not pollute any more than X amount.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, with all the carbon or with the credits that we're talking about, I mean, I don't think that there are a lot of farmers who are local small farmers who couldn't necessarily compete with the larger farmers when they can, you know, they obviously have the capital to buy these different credits at their whim.
Mm-hmm. One of the problems that we will probably be facing going forward is the problem of, well, continuing to face is the problem of inflation. And I'm guessing that everybody here would agree that inflation is largely a function of whatever the Federal Reserve does in monetary creation. Are we all agreed on that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. What is the role of the Federal Reserve, should there be one?
Well, I'd argue that you know, localities and different banks should be able to set up, you know, their own currencies backed by their own different systems, so that, you know, it's more of an individualized system. Now, if there is, you know, if the federal government feels that it's necessary to set up a national currency, which I believe it is, then, you know, it should be up to Congress and it should be transparent, where if there's a problem, we can vote, you know, we can vote them out. If we find that what they're doing is economically harmful to us as the citizens, we should be able to say, no, you can't make those decisions, and we're going to remove you for that.
What about a gold standard? Worked well for quite a long time until Roosevelt got rid of it.
I think that there should be a gold standard. You know, if there should definitely be something to back up what we have or what we claim that we have. So if nothing else, it definitely has to be gold or precious metals of various types.
You have a feeling on a Federal Reserve role or lack of one?
While every fiber in my being wants to say that we should, you know, basically remove the Federal Reserve, I do have hesitations, because I think that you could run into some very serious problems if you do it hastily and without much thought put behind it. So that's why I would say, first things first, let's get our house in order, audit the Federal Reserve, see exactly what we're dealing with, what has been occurring over the last decade or two, what sort of shape we're in, where a lot of the...
Or century.
Or century. Well, yeah, I mean, you would have to go back to 1913, I suppose, or 1914. But, yeah, I am very sympathetic to those who say we should get rid of the Federal Reserve.
What about Ron Paul's idea, competing currencies? Just let anybody, let people, if they want to trade, if they want to use gold to settle debts and obligations, that's fine. If they want to use dollars, that's fine. Would that be an incremental way of solving the problem?
Well, I think so, definitely. I think that gold needs to be seen as a currency again, or at least precious metals of some type. Like I said, you know, in this kind of market, there are all kinds of different things that you could be using for currency. Or all kinds of different metals that you could be using for currency. I think that gold is definitely the most basic, and we should definitely be seeing that more as, instead of a jewelry or some other type of thing, it should be a currency.
Thank you very much. We're running out of time, but great. Thank you for being a part of the show. See you again next week, same time, same place, on the Libertarian Counterpoint and on the web at www.accesssacramento.org at noon on Friday and 4 a.m. on Saturday and 8 p.m. on Thursday.